Welcome to the second oldest house in Zelienople.
This was the home of Christian Buhl.
Let's walk in and take a tour.
Welcome to the Buhl House. And until a year and a half ago, this was the oldest house in Zelienople. Why is it not the oldest house in Zelienople? Well, an architect took a tour of the house, and after completing the tour, he said, this wasn't the oldest house in Zelienople. It wasn't built in 1803. It was built later. And we thought, oh, another troublemaker from Cranberry coming in here. Surely, when they started the Historical Society 50 years ago, they would have looked up all this information. But one of our people went up to Butler to the courthouse, checked the records, and sure enough, he was right. This house was built in 1819. So it is the second oldest house in Zelienople. The oldest house is a Pasman house just up the street here. And with that, we'll begin our tour. Back in 1803 in Germany, things were going haywire in Germany. Germany had lost another war. And there was a family by the name of Christian Buhl who lived in Germany. And the Buhl family had lived there for generations and generations and generations. They were furriers, hatters, and trappers. They made men's top hats, which were very popular at that time. Sold them all through Germany and all through Europe. But after the war, there was chaos in Germany, and Christian Buhl, who was 27 years old, decides he's had enough of this, he's going to America. He lands in Philadelphia. He stays in a section of Philadelphia called Germantown, which is still there today. But back then, it was a conclave of German immigrants. Christian Buhl taught English. Every German who came to this country knew they had to learn and master English if they were going to be successful. And Christian Buhl had mastered English because he had to sell his hats in England. So he's teaching English one day, and one of the older German guys come up and said, hey, kid, what are you doing here? You're 27 years old. You're single. You got some money. Go out to the West Coast. Go out to Pittsburgh. And this was the West Coast of the colonies. You went into Ohio. That was the Badlands. That was Indian territory. This was it. So Christian Buhl says, well, what is in Pittsburgh? And the man said, well, there's a little bit of everything. There's wildlife. There's Indians. But most of all, there's opportunity. Well, Christian Buhl thought it over and he said, yep, that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to Pittsburgh. Now, this part of my story may cause you to roll your eyes, but it is true. He walked from Philadelphia to Pittsburgh, well over 300 and some miles. Now, feel free to roll your eyes. You won't hurt my feelings. Maybe just a little bit. He walked from Philadelphia to Reading. That was his first part of his journey. And Reading was about 50 miles from Philadelphia. He meets a group of people over there called the Pennsylvania Dutch. Now, out here, we have the Amish and we have the Mennonites. They're a very clannish, passive group of people. Not so with the Pennsylvania Dutch. First of all, they're not Dutch. They're Germans. And through a translation error, the word Deutsch came out Dutch. And instead of being Pennsylvania Germans, they were called Pennsylvania Dutch. And they said, well, just leave it that way. We're Pennsylvania Dutch. They fought in the Revolutionary War against Britain. They were on our side. And Christian Buhl said he learned more about America from the Pennsylvania Dutch than he ever did from any textbook in Germany. And he thought so highly of the Pennsylvania Dutch that he was going to stay in Reading. But then that light bulb went up over his head. He said, nope, I'm supposed to go to Pittsburgh. And just as a sidebar, this is a man who came from Germany where the national drink is beer. He said he never saw anybody drink beer like the Pennsylvania Dutch. They would drink it from morning to night. They would never be inebriated, never affected their work. He didn't know how they did it, but they did it. So he leaves Reading, walks another 50 miles to a hamlet, another 50 miles, and he ends up in Pittsburgh. And in Pittsburgh, he meets Detmar Bassi, the founder of Zelienople. And they hit it off. They're both Germans. They like hiking, fishing, camping, and the great outdoors. And Detmar Bassi says, hey, buddy, I'm building a town 30 miles north of here. Why don't you come out and take a look at it? Well, Christian Buhl, who just walked 300 and some miles from Philadelphia, said walking 30 miles out to Zelienople, that would be nothing. So he walks out here, he comes through town. The first thing he notices is the Koninklijke Crypt. But folks, he saw no water in the Koninklijke Crypt. He saw money in the Koninklijke Crypt. Back in Germany, he was a furrier, a hatter, and a trapper. He said, I can do the same thing here. That crypt is full of beavers and otters. This is where God wants me in the new world. So he settled down, built a log cabin on the north side of town, set up his traps, caught beavers, processed the pelts, made beautiful men's top hats, and took them to Pittsburgh. And he sold them at top dollar. And for the next year, he made the run between Zelienople and Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh and Zelienople making all kinds of money. Now, this guy had money when he got here. Now he's having more money. And he's having a great time, except he's getting kind of lonesome. He'd like to have a girlfriend. He looks around town, and so he went over to Harmony. And Harmony's right against Zelienople. You cross the street, you're in Harmony. He goes into Harmony. He's looking for love. Sadly, I must report, Christian Buhl did not find love in Harmony. And he's very disgusted. And one of the Harmony residents come up to him and said, "Hey, pal, we're getting a new group of Germans coming to town here. Maybe we'll find a girlfriend there." And he is so excited for about 5 minutes until another Harmony resident said, "Don't get excited, buddy. This new group of Germans coming to town, they're called Harmonists. They don't believe in reproduction. They are celibate. And this is one reason they went out of business." Christian Buhl is really ticked off now about this. What's he going to do? So he decides to walk out to Cranberry. And at that time in history, there were more cranberries in Cranberry than there were people. That's why it's called Cranberry. They had cranberry bogs out there. But he met a farm girl. Her name was Frederica Dorothea Gearing. And they fell in love. And after a courtship of about 1 year, they were married. This room was her formal parlor, which means you stayed out of this room. You run up the loaf, you go upstairs and relax upstairs. When little Charlotte, their daughter who was killed accidentally, she was laid out in this room. They would have parties in this room. Now, how many people you can get in this room, I don't know, but that's where they would have their parties. This is the man we're talking about. This is Christian Buhl. He lived to be 88 years old. Unheard of back then. Men were lucky to make it to 60. But his wife is the real jewel. She lived to be 90. She had 11 children. Childbirth was very dangerous back then. She took care of the family. She ran up and down 3 flights of steps, and she also ran the business. Christian Buhl always said if it wasn't for his wife, he would not have been as successful as he was. These are all 11 children that they have. 11 children, Grace. They had 11 children. And if Albert Einstein ever helps us out and becomes a tour guide, he can memorize them all. But since he's not available and Grace is not available to memorize them all, we have everything up on the wall. So when you come here, you'll be able to read about each and every one of them. All were very successful. 2 were mayors of Detroit, Michigan. They were in the fuel business, the iron ore business, the steel business. And 1 granddaughter was even in show business. And at that time in history, show business was really sleazy. But she became a fine opera singer, and she sang in Europe. Have you ever heard the term mad as a hatter? Have you, Grace? Have you ever heard mad as a hatter? Well, it was true. If you were a hatter making hats, when you would take the fur off the beavers or otters, you would use any type of chemical you could find. You would find mercury or formaldehyde or anything like that. And you inhale this year after year after year, your brain turns to shredded wheat. People would go mad. But it did not happen to Christian Buhl. He really lucked out on that. This is the type of hat we're talking about. He had different varieties of hats, but this was his mainstay, this type of hat, where he made his fortune. Have you ever collected autographs? Grace, have you ever collected autographs? Has anybody out there ever collected autographs? Well, Christian Buhl collected autographs. Here is his autograph book. It's right in our case here. It's very fragile. If you came to the Buhl house today, he would get your autograph, and he would remember you. Grace, did he get your autograph when you were here? He did. So anybody coming in would get their autograph. And why did he do that? Because he had a very good memory. And if you came back 2 years later or 5 years later, he would remember something about you. We always hoped that maybe George Washington's autograph would be in here. But George Washington came through town about 50 years before Christian Buhl got to town. You'll notice that big spinning wheel over there. It's called a walk-around spinning wheel. And if you were a wealthy family, you had it. Or if you were in the fur business, you had it. All the girls had to learn to sew because that was part of being in the fur business. Well, thank you for taking a brief tour of the Buhl House. We cordially invite you to come back every Thursday night between May and Halloween in October. We have the micro mini whirlwind tour of the first floor. And come back during horse trading days, which is in the middle of July. And all 3 floors of the Buhl House are open. Also, the Pasman House is open, plus our guards. And it's free back then. So on behalf of my colleague Grace and the rest of the staff of the Zelienople Historical Society, thank you for being with us.